All right, I'm going to start by giving you yet another idea for your project. And then I'm actually going to stay away from Mathematica for quite a while and maybe only come back to it at the end and focus on facts and theorems that you should know about integration. Here's something that you could relate to the project. Vector fields and flows. Basically, anytime you have a vector field, a continuous vector field, say, you can think of it as representing a flow of a thin sheet of fluid, okay? And you don't really worry too much in math whether it's physically realistic or not, okay? You just imagine, use your imagination. You see the vector field, and you imagine that each vector in the vector field is like a velocity vector for, say, water molecules in a thin sheet. At every point here, it says that at every point, the vector, the output of the vector field that you draw at a given point, so here's your given point x, y, you got some vector, that's the output of the vector field at that point. You think of that as a velocity vector for any molecule that passes through this point at any moment in time. Technically speaking, to try to visualize that more precisely, you need to use differential equations. The streamlines of this flow are parameter curves, which are solutions of the system differential equations. They are functions that satisfy these properties for all t in an appropriate domain. Stream plot in Mathematica can plot these streamlines. We can also plot the rescaled vector field itself in vector plot and any equilibrium points where the vector field is zero with a list plot. That's what we're going to do right here. So I'm entering the vector field right now. I'm solving for equilibrium points. Evidently, some numerical errors occurring here. I'm sure this is the origin, as well as these two. Evidently, maybe the origin is a triple root, and some slight numerical errors coming in there. So essentially, it seems like we have three equilibrium points. And here's what the vector field looks like, along with the stream plot and the equilibrium points. Here we're not talking about complex analysis. This is just vector fields. The red arrows are the rescaled vectors in the vector field, all scaled to have the same length. The blue curves, that's the stream plot. That's the paths of the water molecules in thin sheets of fluid. I believe this point is a sink. So a lot of the water molecules are heading toward that as if they're going down a sink. And these two, I believe, are what are called saddle points. Don't worry about that. You can just imagine the water molecules following these paths. Is there any way to animate this? Well, yes. If it's a simple enough system, if it's like a linear system, notice that these functions are linear. These are my right-hand side functions for the differential equations. Then d sol value is enough to solve the system. You can find formulas for the solutions. And there they are at an arbitrary initial condition, x of 0 equals x0 and y of 0 equals y0. You can create a function that has goes through those the given point x0, y0 at time 0 that is a solution that matches what you see here. It's a function of time. And then you can put it inside the stream plot with manipulating various kinds of ways. Here's the way I chose to do it this time. Oh, I worked on my computer. What's going on? Did I not finish this? Why did this work on my computer but not on here? Okay, I'm not sure why this is not working here. It did work on my computer. I tested this last night and it worked. What I was hoping to do, and I'll have to try to figure out what's wrong after class, is plot a bunch of points in the stream plot as if they're water molecules and follow the paths of those water molecules. And like I said, it worked on my computer. I don't know what went wrong here. So I'll try to figure that out in after class. I don't think I should spend time during class trying to figure it out. As far as your project goes, if you wanted to do something similar to this, You could consider trying to use any solve value for a nonlinear system, which is trickier. If you had diffq, you might remember using any solve value instead of d solve value. If you didn't have diffq, then you don't know how to do that, perhaps, and so maybe that's not a good project idea for you. But for those who've had diffq, this might be a good project idea. You would try to do it for a nonlinear system. And of course, you got to relate it to complex analysis. But that's not too hard. You can relate it to complex analysis because you can talk about the vector fields associated with a complex function. Let's say an analytic function. Are there anything special about vector fields and stream plots for analytic functions? That would be how you can relate it to complex analysis. I don't know why that didn't work. All right, so now I'm going to move away from using Mathematica for a while here today. We have talked about the Cauchy-Goursat Theorem. But I think, once again, it would be good to do a quick review this time of everything we've talked about leading up to this point to get it straightened up in your mind. I know with this stuff, personally, myself, I always have to remind myself whatever everything means. And you probably feel the same way. So let's go through and remind ourselves of all the kinds of things that we've learned here. We've got some givens. Okay, you've got, first of all, a domain that's a subset of the complex plane. Again, domain meaning open and connected. And it will be an ordinary domain for a function because we do have a function F, whose domain is the complex domain D, and whose codomain is C. So we've got a complex valued function of a complex variable. And you've got a contour, capital gamma, that's a subset of D. It could be a smooth contour, a smooth curve, or it could be made up of pieces, for example, sides of a square, like this. Call this side gamma 1, this side gamma 2, this side gamma 3, and this side gamma 4. Gamma could be thought of as the sum of these individual pieces. And when you integrate over gamma itself, you integrate over each piece and add the integrals. That's by definition. I should say this is an oriented contour, so let me add an and put the word oriented in there. Got an orientation in the picture specified by the arrows. As far as parameterizations go, you've got to come up with a parameterization that's consistent with the orientation. You can then define the integral of f of z over gamma via a limit of Riemann sums. What kind of limit of Riemann sums? Well, that can get pretty technical. If you took real analysis last fall, you remember Riemann sums can get really, really technical. Suffice it to say, our book doesn't quite go into the technicality that we do in real analysis. Let me just say Riemann sums of the form sum of f of zi times delta zi, going from 1 to n, where the pictorially, you can take the zi's to be points on this curve, like this. They don't have to be equally spaced in distance along the curve or in time if it's a parameterization. And you can take the delta zi's, delta z1 and the delta z2, to be the displacements between these dots here. That's one way you can visualize such a Riemann sum. There are generalizations of this. You can take the zi's to be in between these points, if you like, the sample points that you plug into the function f. Anyway, you take a limit of Riemann sums of this form as all of the delta zi's go to zero. As you get more and more sample points that are getting closer and closer to together, so all the delta zi's go to zero. We're not going to focus on this. You know, you can use this idea to approximate the integral, and I did that once with Mathematica, and it was a pain. that. That's not our focus. In real analysis, we do do the theory of integration in such a way that we do talk about Riemann sums in enough depth to do proofs. But here, that's not the goal. But I remind you that it can be and should be technically defined that way. As far as calculating it, we use a parameterization. Z of t for t between a and b, where z of t is complex value, and therefore would have a real and imaginary part that you'd probably want to call x of t and y of t, like that. It does correspond to a real parameterization of the curve if you thought of the plane as being a real plane instead of the complex plane, that you'd more often write in vector form like this. And that would be a corresponding real parameterization of the same contour, except you think of it as lying in the real plane rather than the complex plane. How do you use the parameterization? By calculating the integral from a to b of f of z of t, so you plug the parameterization into f, and then don't forget to multiply times z prime of t, which is really like a velocity vector, like that. How you can actually calculate the integral. We want to relate this to two real line integrals. In doing so, I'm going to use sloppy notation, and I'm going to suppress the t's, the time, for the sake of time, okay, so that I can write this more quickly. But you should remember that everything does depend on t, ultimately. Actually, let's think of it in this form first, with replacing dz by a differential as a different complex differential dx plus I dy. So actually here, that maybe it's best not to think of it in any t. I'm going to write this as f is u plus iv. I'm going to go ahead and suppress the x and y here. U and v are functions of x and y. Think of dz as dx plus I dy. Now pretend this is a multiplication. Go ahead and expand that out. We are doing just suggestive math here. It's a conceptual fiction about pretending that we're multiplying here, for the sake of getting the right symbolism in the end. What's the real part? Well, you gotta FOIL this out. U dx is part of the real part. There's no I there. You also, from last times last, get IV times I dy. I squared is negative 1, so that gives you negative V dy. That's the real part. And then the imaginary part comes from outside and inside products. U times I dy is I times u dy. And then you also have v dx. Let's put the one with the dx first. V dx plus u dy. And that is the same thing, coming back to multivariable calculus notation, as the line integrals of the vector fields u negative v plus I times the line integral of the vector field VU. So these are multivariable calculus kinds of line integrals here that we can calculate with parameterization. You think of it as being this parameterization. And it would give us the same thing as if we expanded this form of the integral. Let's go ahead and expand this form. Here I will suppress the t's. There I was really suppressing the x's and y's in terms of the inputs for u and v. Go ahead and expand this out. Here we are actually doing an actual multiplication. Here it was just a pretend multiplication. The real part is going to come from u times x prime minus v times y prime. Everything there does depend on t, but I'm suppressing the t's. The imaginary part comes again from outside and inside terms. Put the one with the x prime first, vx prime plus uy prime. And those are dot products. This is the same as u comma negative v dot with x prime comma y prime, the velocity vector. And this is the same as v comma u dot with the velocity vector x prime comma y prime. These are the same things you get when you use the parameterizations to do this integral, these integrals here. Okay, so we can relate it to multivariable calculus, which is useful now here as we come to the Cauchy-Goursat Theorem. What does the Cauchy-Goursat Theorem say? This is often just called Cauchy's Theorem or Cauchy's Integral Theorem. I want to give Goursat some credit though. To really generalize this a bit, this is the statement I'm going to write down is more general than what we actually prove. If D is a simply connected domain, in the complex plane, and F of Z is analytic on D, then the integral of f of z around any closed contour, gamma, I should have maybe emphasized gamma was a closed contour in D first. I'll just do it this way, I'll draw an arrow to gamma here. This is a closed contour in D, it comes back to where it starts. Really it should be, in the most ideal situation here, it should be a simple closed contour, meaning the only time it intersects itself is when it comes back to where it starts. It's not like a figure eight or something. A simple closed contour. That integral is zero. Should be oriented to. Technically, the integral is zero whether the orientation is in the usual positive direction or negative direction. But as far as the proof goes, we'll think about it in the usual positive orientation because we're going to use Green's theorem. And Green's theorem is stated in terms of a positive orientation, a counterclockwise orientation around the simple closed contour. And using Green's theorem to prove this, we really are not proving the full generality. We're proving a weaker version, assuming not only that f is analytic, but also that its derivative is continuous. That's the extra assumption that we'd be using if we need to use Green's theorem to prove it. But it's true even if you don't assume f prime is continuous. It will turn out that if f is analytic, f prime will be continuous. That will turn out to be true. But this can be proved even if you don't assume that, or assume that you know that. Right? Say that again. This is the general version of the theorem. We're not going to fully prove this. We will also add the assumption that f prime is continuous on D. But this can be proved without that extra assumption. Why is it necessary to make that extra assumption? to prove it with the method that we're going to talk about here is necessary because it's necessary to assume those facts about the corresponding partial derivatives of the real and imaginary parts in order to apply Green's theorem. Green's theorem can be used to prove this, but only in the weaker version where you assume f prime is also continuous. I'm just going to do the idea. I'm not going to write any sentences here. So here's your simple closed contour gamma. Let's say oriented counterclockwise so that we can apply Green's theorem as stated in the usual form. You can actually come up with a statement of Green's theorem that would be valid if it was the negative orientation clockwise. You need to essentially change signs on the right-hand side of the equation. There's our oriented closed curve. Let's call the inside of that closed curve, along with the closed curve itself, oh, how about D prime? I'm already using the letter D. D prime is sitting in the bigger domain D. And actually, since D prime includes the closed contour, D prime is actually a closed set. So it's not a domain in the usual sense. Essentially, we come back to the multivariable calculus integrals, whose sum like this equals the integral we're interested in. We apply Green's theorem to both of those vector fields. So we have the integral of f of z over gamma, and again, you can put a circle here and an arrow there if you want. You don't have to. You don't have to do that, but to emphasize that the contour is closed and, say, positively oriented. I'm going to go ahead and write that. You can do it with the real integrals, too. Go ahead and draw that circle with an arrow. Now apply Green's theorem. Each of these line integrals, these real line integrals, can be related to a certain double integral. D prime is of D. Double integral of what's called the scalar curl. What's the scalar curl of a vector field? You've got a vector field, well, let me use p's and q's like I usually do here. F equals pq, those are the components in your vector field. The scalar curl of f, sometimes written curl sub z of f, is the partial derivative of the second component with respect to the first variable minus the partial derivative of the first component with respect to the second variable. It's called a scalar curl. Can you see that okay? It's called a scalar curl because it's a special case of a fuller vector curl. Technically speaking, the idea of a curl is best thought of in terms of three-dimensional vectors. You take a curl of a three-dimensional vector field, you get another vector field that's also three-dimensional. And essentially, we're taking the last z component of that. You know, if you added a third component of zero here, this would be the third component of the vector curl. It's a scalar instead of a vector, it's the third component, so we put a z there. That's a little confusing though here in complex analysis because it makes you think it's the complex variable z, but it's not. I won't bother changing it though. Coming to these particular line integrals here then, and applying this idea, what's the scalar curl? Look at this one here, you've got to take the partial of the second component, which is negative v, with respect to the first variable, and subtract the partial of the first component with respect to the second variable. There's the scalar curl for that vector field. What's the scalar curl for this one? Again, same idea, go to the second component and differentiate it with respect to the first variable, and subtract the derivative of the first component with respect to the second variable. We talked about this last week, how you finish it. It's pretty much just like that. How? Cauchy-Riemann equation. I'm assuming f of z is analytic. I can use the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Du dx equals dv dy. Therefore, this difference is identically zero. Always zero. When something's identically zero, sometimes people put three marks for your equal sign. Have you seen that before? Put three lines for your equal sign to say this is identically zero, meaning always zero over the whole domain. Same thing with this one. That derivative is the same as the opposite of the derivative of v with respect to x. Du dy equals the opposite of dv dx. So if I subtract them, this is identically zero as well. Getting you u plus, 0 plus I times 0 is 0. I need the assumption that these partial derivatives are continuous to say that Green's theorem applies here. So we essentially prove the weaker version of Cauchy-Goursat here. We're not going to go into the fully general proof because it's much harder. This is going to be good enough for us. We can do a little bit more relating to multivariable calculus here before we go on. Keep this short though. So these scalar curls are identically zero. What else did we learn about at the end of multivariable calculus with vector fields? We learned about conservative vector fields and potential functions. Remember those things? When the scalar curl is zero over a simply connected domain, identically zero, that means the vector field is actually conservative, meaning it's got a potential function. There is some function whose gradient is the vector field. So evidently these two vector fields are conservative, so they must have a potential function. We are in a simply connected domain. What would the potential function be? Well, if I assume little f happened to have an antiderivative, it does actually. Capital F of z, antiderivative of little f of z for all z in the domain, it's going to turn out that analytic functions do have antiderivatives. We haven't proved that, but that will end up being true. It's going to turn out the real and imaginary parts of capital F are potential functions for these two vector fields. Let's see why. Say capital F equals, well, how about capital U plus I times capital V? What's the derivative of capital F? Well, of course it equals little f. I'm going to suppress the z's here, and the x's and y's for that matter. I hope you remember from the section where we talked about the Cauchy-Riemann equations, section 2.3 was it? 2.4, that we actually came up with a formula for the derivative of an analytic function in terms of partial derivatives of the real imaginary parts. You can write capital F prime as the partial of capital U with respect to X plus I times the partial of capital V with respect to X. If you don't believe me, and if you have your book, look at page 73. That's where it is. Section about the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Essentially, I've written down equation one here in terms of capital F. I could also write this as, well, essentially by the Cauchy-Riemann equations and in their derivation, as the opposite, the partial of v with respect to y minus I times the partial of v with respect to x. No, with respect to y. It's easy to get mixed up. That's also true by the Cauchy-Riemann equations, essentially applied to capital F. How is this helpful? Well, let's calculate the gradient of capital U and the gradient of capital V. By definition, the gradient of capital U is the derivative of capital U with respect to X, comma the derivative of capital U with respect to Y. What do those things equal? Well, they equal the real and imaginary parts. This thing is the real part of little f. These things equal u, little u plus I times little v. So the partial v with respect to x equals little u. And the partial v with respect to y, look here and compare, must be the opposite of little v. See that? Those two things have to equal. Partial v with respect to y has to be the opposite of little v. In other words, the gradient of u is this vector field, the conjugate vector field, phi bar. And what about the gradient of v? By definition, it equals this, but what do those partials equal? Vx, look right there, compare with there, equals little v. And vy, look here and here, equals little u. V is a potential function, capital V is a potential function for this vector field. Okay? These are both conservative vector fields, they have potential functions. These integrals are zero, these integrals are independent of path. All those facts about conservative vector fields apply. They might be useful. All right, on to something new. I'd like to, instead of just stating what comes next, I'd like to try to derive it. And so what I'm going to write down are a bunch of manipulations on the board that are going to help me derive something kind of interesting. I hope you see. Let's pretend we've got an oriented closed contour, oriented with the positive orientation, say. There's gamma. And we're integrating, well, you've got a function that's analytic on gamma and inside gamma. Which really means it's analytic on some domain that contains gamma. Some openly connected set containing gamma. It also means that openly connected set would be simply connected, because the inside of gamma is simply connected. But I'm not going to integrate f here. I'm going to integrate f of z divided by z minus z zero. Where z zero is some point inside gamma. I forgot to emphasize that. Okay. The first trick I'm going to use is something I haven't mentioned yet, but if you fully read section 4.4, including the first half, it should be familiar to you. Something called the Deformation Invariance Theorem, and it's essentially equivalent to Cauchy-Goursat Theorem. It's used to prove the Cauchy-Goursat Theorem in the first half of section. If I take this oriented closed contour and continuously deform it, and still say and stay inside the bigger domain, D, which I would, since the inside of gamma is still inside of D, the integral around any deformed version of gamma is going to be the same as the integral around. Deformation invariance is the technical name for that. Let me deform it to a circle centered at z0 of a certain radius. We call that radius r. And the circle, let's give a name to it, let's call it C sub r. And it's an oriented curve, circle with the same orientation. The deformation invariance theorem says that the integral of this function around both curves, gamma and CR, is the same. Actually, the function that I'm integrating is not analytic on D because I'm dividing by Z minus Z0, so it's undefined at Z0. So it can't be analytic at z0, but in deforming gamma to the circle, I'm staying in even that non-simply connected domain, and that's okay for the deformation invariance theorem. If you look at the deformation invariance theorem, you just say that these are the domain, and as you continuously deform the given contour, you just have to stay inside the domain. You do not need to assume that the domain is simply connected. Deformation invariance theorem is on page 186. F is analytic in a domain, nothing about the domain being simply connected, containing two loops or closed contours that can be continuously deformed into each other, staying in the domain the whole time. Now I'm going to do a trick. I'm going to add zero to the numerator in a convenient way. And the convenient way is going to be like this. Subtract f of z0 and add f of z0. And then I'm going to use algebra facts to break that fraction apart into two fractions. f of z minus f of z0 divided by z minus z0 plus f of z0 divided by z minus z0. And now by linearity properties of integrals, which are true, you can definitely use those properties. The integral of a sum is the sum of the integrals. So I can break the integral of the sum into two pieces. And let me also rearrange the pieces. Let me put the integral of f of z0 over z minus z0 first, and the other integral second. Does this provide any insight into what this integral is? It does, actually, if you think carefully about it. Look at this first integral. Z0 is a constant. So f of z0 is a constant and can be factored out. And what I'm left with is an integral around a small circle centered at z0 of 1 over z minus z0. That's one of those special examples I mentioned last Friday. An important class of examples. A fundamental class of examples. These kinds of integrals. What did I say about it? I said if n was not equal to negative 1, then these integrals were 0. But if n did equal negative 1, so you're really integrating 1 over z minus z0, then the answer was 2 pi I. I should have read about that too. I'm in a case here where n is negative 1. And again, f of z0 is just a constant. That integral right there equals 2 pi I times f of z0. So what have we derived? We've derived that this integral that we started with, where you've got f of z in the numerator and z minus z0 in the denominator. Well, it equals that integral over the small circle centered at z0. And that ultimately leads us to saying it equals 2 pi I times f of z0 plus this integral. And evidently, this would be true no matter how small CR was, as long as it's inside gamma. So evidently, this thing really doesn't depend on R. This thing must be a constant no matter what R is. What constant is it? It turns out that the limit, as R goes to 0, of this integral equals 0, and therefore the integral itself actually always equals 0. You prove this integral always equals 0 by proving this limit is 0. And the book does prove it. I'm not going to take the time to. It's a proof you should study. It's actually not super hard. It's not super easy either. But it's not super hard if you use some inequalities related to integrals that I haven't mentioned yet. The limit of this integral as r goes to 0 can be proved to be 0 pretty easily. But this has got to be a constant, so in fact it's always 0 no matter what r is. And therefore we have derived that this integral back here really just equals 2 pi I times f of z0. Stated another way, if I divide both sides by 2 pi I, I can write f of z0 is 1 over 2 pi I times the integral of f of z over z minus z0 over gamma, where gamma is any positively oriented closed contour surrounding z0 in the domain. Where f of z is analytic on gamma and inside gamma, meaning really it's analytic on some domain, some open connected set containing gamma. Kind of a weird formula, but it is true. It's called the Cauchy Integral Formula. More credit for Cauchy. Cauchy Integral Formula. Kind of a strange formula. Is it useful? It is amazingly useful. There's also some generalizations of it that I'm going to mention in a few minutes that are useful. What are these things useful for? They're useful for two things. One is they do help you evaluate certain integrals. That's one application. Secondly, and perhaps more importantly, they help you study analytic functions. In fact, we're going to see very shortly on Wednesday, if not next Wednesday after that, because we have a short week this week and a short week next week because of Easter. Either this Wednesday or a week from Wednesday, we're going to see that you can prove the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, and excuse me, Fundamental Theorem of Algebra. With this. What did the Fundamental Theorem of Algebra say? It says that every non-constant polynomial with coefficients in C, complex coefficients, has at least one root in C, and therefore you can extend that to saying it has n roots counting multiplicities in C. You don't need some bigger number system beyond C. It's called the Fundamental Theorem of Algebra. It must be pretty important. It's proof, the original proof by Gauss a couple hundred years ago, 218 years, I believe, to be exact, 1799. It was very difficult. The original proof was very difficult. And other purely algebraic proofs were very difficult. But we're going to see that this formula and its generalizations can prove the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. Algebra. Oh, about one page worth of proofs. A couple proofs put together. Depending on maybe one page of complex analysis. In other words, it's a very quick proof. The quickest proof possible of the Fundamental Theorem of Algebra. It's kind of fancy because we're using a fancy looking thing, but the fanciness is worth it because we have a short proof of it with this. This can also be used to prove this in its generalizations, again, which I'm going to write down in a minute. It can also be used to prove that analytic functions are not only differentiable, they are infinitely differentiable. They not only have a first derivative, which is all you assume from the start of an analytic function, but they have a second derivative, a third derivative, a fourth derivative, etc., forever and ever. And all those derivatives not only exist, they're also continuous. To generalize this, we're first going to rewrite it in a different form. The book does this too. I'd like to think of this integral as actually defining a function now, to generalize this, rather than just a fact about a function value. I'd like to think of this as a variable now. We can use such an integral to define a function f of z. Given its values along gamma, we want to define f of z in the interior of gamma. So z here is going to play the role of z0 here. What's going to play the role over here of z over here? We jump to a Greek letter. It's the Greek version of z, zeta. Looks like this. Do we have to use a zeta? No, it's just traditional. Do you agree that these equations are essentially saying the same thing? Gamma is a positively oriented closed contour, simple closed contour. Here z0 was a point inside gamma. Here z is a point inside gamma. Zeta is just a variable of integration. These equations say the same thing. But it's worth it now for the change in perspective to say, now I'm thinking of this as defining a function f of z based on boundary values of the function f of zeta, where zeta varies along the simple closed contour of gamma. And I wonder if I could differentiate this function. What would its derivative be? You might hope that you could differentiate this function by differentiating the integrand. That you could put the derivative operator inside the integral. Like this.
Try to make my zetas recognize.
Can you do that? The answer is yes, but it takes proof. Actually, the proof that you can do that is longer and harder than the proof that the book does with the original Cauchy Integral Formula. We're going to just trust it here and see where it leads us. Differentiate this with respect to z. Now, in the derivative here, zeta is constant. For the integral, zeta is the variable. But for the derivative here, with respect to z, zeta is constant. This is none other than f of zeta times zeta minus z to the negative 1 power. Differentiate that with respect to z with the chain rule. I bring the negative 1 down in front. I get a negative 2 there, and I'd also multiply the negative 1 by the chain. And it would give me f of zeta over zeta
minus z quantity squared.
This takes proof to say that you can do this. And again, it's a harder proof. It is in the book, you should study it. I may go over it, and I may want you to be able to maybe verify parts of it on the test, exam three. By the way, I am getting pretty close to finishing your grading your exams. It's a proof that's worth studying, worth understanding. It is understandable, okay? It's not like something you can't understand. It's in the textbook, you can understand this one, but it's a bit tricky. We can continue this process. What about the second derivative of this function? We might once again hope we can bring the derivative operator inside the integral. And this is nothing other than f of zeta times zeta minus z quantity to the negative 2 power. Differentiate with respect to z, bring the negative 2 in front, get negative 3 there, and also multiply by negative 1. The negative signs go away. But I do get an extra 2 here that can cancel with the 2 out there. Let me not cancel it actually, but I will write it as 2 factorial over 2 pi I. Of course, 2 factorial is 2. Times the integral over gamma of f of zeta over zeta minus z cubed d zeta. I could continue. I could find the third derivative. I get an extra factor of 3. I'd get a 3 factorial there. Question?
In the first derivative, were we supposed to have a negative somewhere?
It canceled. Because the negative 1 comes down, but I also get another negative 1 for
okay.
The third derivative would involve a 3 factorial there and a 4 there. The fourth derivative would involve a 4 factorial here and a 5 there. In general, the nth derivative of f at z is n factorial divided by 2 pi I times the integral over gamma of f of zeta over zeta minus z to the n plus 1 power d zeta. And this is called the generalized Cauchy integral formula. And is a useful thing for two reasons: to evaluate integrals and to help us study analytic functions and prove lots of properties about them that you can't prove with just a theory of differentiation. You need the theory of integration to prove these other things. We're about out of time. I do have today's Mathematica notebook on Moodle. And I've got some animations in it that are worth looking at and thinking about. I'll probably show them to you on Wednesday as well. Your homework that you should work on before Wednesday mostly involves using these formulas to do integrals, right? If you solve for the integrals by multiplying both sides by 2 pi I, evidently you can evaluate the integrals by taking 2 pi I times some derivative of the function evaluated at some point. And there are examples in the book. Okay, so we'll do at least one or two examples of that also on Wednesday. But then we're going to get into proving some important theorems related to these facts. Okay, that are useful for doing some pretty amazing things. All right, we'll see you on Wednesday.